Welcome to the video series, The Operational Amplifier, From Abstraction to Reality. You'll look at how a rail-to-rail op amp works and become familiar with its benefits and pitfalls. Why rail-to-rail performance? It has mostly been driven by the demand for decreasing power source voltages. Many products operate as low as a single 1.5-volt battery supply. In the case of the inverting amplifier, the common mode voltage is restricted usually to the middle of the supply or ground. Unless the non-inverting input is biased close to the rail, a rail-to-rail op amp is not needed for an inverting amplifier. The non-inverting amplifier presents the biggest challenge, as its common mode voltage range must span the full input voltage range. A distinction is made between the devices that have rail-to-rail inputs, or RRI, and rail-to-rail outputs, or RRO. A key question is, do you really need a rail-to-rail op amp? We will look at the various drawbacks and problems with rail-to-rail op amps and some alternative applications. Here's a review from the Peek Inside the Op Amp video. A common mode voltage source, VCM, is connected to both the inverting and non-inverting input. Oftentimes, the input of the op amp will be near ground or somewhere in the middle between the upper and lower rail. In other cases, the op amp inputs may need to be close to the rails. This op amp configuration has definite common mode input range limitations. There would be a typical 0.3-volt drop across the current source, and a 0.6-volt drop across the emitter base junctions of Q1 and Q2. This means that if the VCM input is greater than VCC minus 0.9 volts, the input transistors will shut down. On the negative side, Q3 has a VBE drop of 0.6 volts. That means if VCM is less than VEE plus 0.6 volts, the current mirror will shut down. In summary, the common mode voltage cannot operate near the rails. Let's look at the input voltage range of the LF411, a regular old op amp, not rail to rail. It shows the input can operate with a differential voltage of 30 volts and a common mode voltage of plus or minus 15 volts, which they call V sub I. Note 1 says, unless otherwise specified, the absolute maximum negative input voltage is equal to the negative power supply voltage. Let's go check it out. I have the LF411 in a voltage follower configuration with a power source of plus and minus 15 volts with a typical load setup. The input is the green trace on top, and the output is the yellow trace. I'm increasing the input voltage. As the minimum voltage gets around minus 13.6 volts, you see what's called phase reversal. It's this terrible thing that can happen to an op amp when common mode voltages are exceeded. This is the advantage of using rail-to-rail op amps so this doesn't happen. Here's the page of the spec that has the common mode input voltage range. This is the operating characteristics for a plus or minus 15 volt power input. The common mode input voltage range on the negative side only goes down to minus 11.5 volts typical, with minus 11 volts as the minimum. Here's what's happening inside. Normally, the tail current caused by Q13 and Q14 is evenly split between J1 and J2. When the positive input goes sufficiently lower than the negative input, J2 becomes forward biased, and it turns off Q4. Q4, being an emitter follower, it then turns off Q5. Q5, being a common emitter amplifier, its collector goes high, which then allows Q6 to turn on, and the output voltage goes high. It's doing the opposite of the expected response, and hence the term phase reversal. Now let's look at a couple op amps that have common mode voltages that include one rail or the other. Here's a simplified block diagram of the LM358. The input shut down at about 2 volts below the positive rail. However, the input P and P transistors have their collectors connected to the negative rail, shown as ground here. This allows the input range to operate down at the negative rail. Conversely, op amps like the TL072 BiFET configuration use P-channel depletion mode JFET inputs with their sources tied to the positive power rail via a bipolar current source. This allows the common mode input voltage range to include the positive power rail, but not the negative rail. Wouldn't it be great if we had the best of both worlds? Well, that's what a rail-to-rail op amp input is. The differential pair input contains a set of NMOS transistors. Those can cover the ranges above its VGS threshold and the drop across its current source, IB. The complementary pair of PMOS transistors covers the range between its VGS threshold and the drop across the current source, IA. Then there's a switch that switches between the two pairs based on an upper and lower DC bias point. In the middle of the range, both sets of transistors are active. I'm sure you're already thinking about all the imperfections caused by this elaborate configuration. I tested the TLV2452 as a unity gain follower, the worst case configuration with these test conditions. There is a noticeable distortion. It looks like typical class AB output stage crossover distortion in the middle of the range, but is not due to the output stage. I reduced the level to a small signal, and there is no noticeable crossover distortion. This distortion only occurs with a large input voltage span. Here's the output high and low spec levels. I'm guessing the low-level distortion is not due to the output stage. This amount of distortion may be unacceptable for any specific application. The unity gain voltage follower is the most stressing case. Oftentimes, you just need to be able to have a common mode voltage to be near one rail or the other, and not both. Another issue caused by switching between the complementary pairs is this wild change in input offset voltage and current with changing common mode input voltage. When both PMOS and NMOS devices are switched on in the center range, the offset characteristics actually cancel each other out and the offsets are very low. It's the common mode range at the extents where only one of the complementary pair is on and the big change occurs. Remember that input bias cancellation resistor I told you not to use? Well, one might help with this particular input. While rail-to-rail inputs really do completely go rail-to-rail, the outputs do not. PMOS and NMOS transistors have definite saturation limits. Also note the test conditions. That's only a high and low output current of 500 microamps. While the outputs are not completely rail-to-rail, it's pretty close, and I'd say it's sufficient for most applications. Here's a useful application for monitoring a negative power supply voltage level for built-in test or power supervision. Oftentimes, you have a single negative supply. All your digital communication is likely on a +5 or +3.3 volt supply. You could sense the -15 volts using an op amp on the -15 volt supply, but if the -15 power dies, it takes away the ability to monitor itself. An inverting amplifier on a positive supply can monitor the negative supply with the non-inverting input at ground. With the non-inverting input at ground, the inverting input is at virtual ground. We just showed how the LM358 can operate with its inputs around ground. Let's say we want the output voltage to be plus 4 volts when the minus 15 volts is exactly minus 15 volts. A nice feature of the inverting amplifier is you can have a gain of less than unity. In this case, a gain of minus 0.266. Bear in mind, too, the low gain reduces the error caused by the input offset voltage. Letting R1 equal 100K yields RF as 26.6K. We can also easily roll off power supply noise by using the opamp as an active filter by adding a single capacitor C1. With a cutoff frequency of 100 Hz, we get C1 as 0.06 microfarads. Here's a circuit for sensing high side current by differential amplification of the voltage across a sense resistor. We can use a non-rail-to-rail op-amp like the TL-072 we looked at earlier, whose common mode voltage range includes the positive rail. VO is simply the load current times the sense resistance times the ratio of R4 to R3. And of course, for a true differential amplifier, R1 equals R3 and R2 equals R4. We select the sense resistor based on the maximum allowable drop we can allow between VCC and the load and the maximum load current. Let's assume a 50 millivolt drop and a max current of 1 amp, which yields 50 milliohms. In order to utilize the maximum output range, we can calculate gain based on the max output span over the current range times the sense resistor, which comes out to 96.3. You may decide to round that down to something more meaningful, like an integer, let's say 90. Let R1 and R3 equal 1K, and calculate R2 and R4 as 96.3K. It's nice to know what the common mode voltage will be. Of course, it's very important to calculate the DC error caused by the input offset voltage when designing high-gain DC amplifiers. The VOS times the noise gain is 389 millivolts. That's an error of 8.4%. Not so good. By choosing an op-amp with a 100 microvolt max input offset voltage makes for a much better error of only 0.2%. However, keep in mind that resistor tolerances used are often 1%, so don't overachieve on offset error. So the takeaway is to choose the right op-amp. In summary, consider carefully whether you need a rail-to-rail op-amp or not. As my example showed, most applications require working near one rail or the other, and not both. The cost of the TVL-2452 I evaluated costs 7 times what a regular op-amp does. Again, a non-inverting unity gain buffer configuration is the biggest challenge. If your amplifier requires much gain, the common mode input is less than a rail's, and less of a problem. When possible, plan your power supplies to be big enough to not need a rail-to-rail amplifier. I know that's difficult when you may only have 3.3 volts or a battery cell available. I also want to mention that I'm not advocating the use of any of these op-amps I cited in these examples or tests. Those op-amps are old designs, and I only use them because that's what I had available. Thanks for watching. Please click the like, subscribe, and notification bell so you don't miss any upcoming content.